Здравствуйте! Сегодня второй день конференции криминализации атомной систем атомной войны. И сегодня я провожу этот день на английском языке, так как у меня на скайпе находится изумительная ученая Лоррейн Мюррей из Америки. И такое счастье у нас сегодня, что мы проведем этот вечер с нею. И вы, которые понимаете английский язык, будете в полном благоухании от этой изумительной, божественной королевы науки, которая никогда не оставила нас без правды. Она все свое время проводит, ища ее. Но теории, которые она использует, конечно, могут быть совершенно уму непостижимыми. Но их надо иметь в виду, потому что если мы ученые, даже самые удивительные теории надо проверить. Okay, Lorraine, now I have told our listeners that you are the queen of science who has never, ever forgotten to study the most unbelievable theories. Because if we are scientists, we have to go and research in even most unbelievable theories. Because if we would just sort of say, oh, that's impossible without checking out, then we would be doing self-censorship, wouldn't we? We wouldn't be scientists. So the floor is yours. So thousand thanks for being with us in this. Because you are on the other side of the planet, aren't you? But we are united now, finding the methodology in criminalization of nuclear war systems. And I'm very grateful that you have sort of been with us through the program of the first conference and have already worked yourself in to the think, the mind of the methodology, which really eases it up for me. And please tell us, how are you today?
I'm just fine, and I'm in Berkeley, California. That's where I live. I started out as a geoscientist. I loved, as a child, being out in the woods and in nature. I felt safe there. And I loved the natural world. And when I went off to university, of course, I didn't know what I wanted to do. But I discovered when I took a geology class as to satisfy the science requirement, I really liked it because you're outdoors most of the time. And I said, I think I'm going to major in this. If I could be outdoors and get paid for it, this is my career. And, of course, there were no women in the geology department then. It was in the 60s, 1960s. And it was a wild ride, I could tell you that. But then I went and traveled around the world for about 10 years, working as a scientist for Dr. Louis Leakey in Africa. I had worked for Dr. Daniel Axelrod, a paleobotanist, for 1 year before I went on my trip around the world. And so I worked with Kew Gardens and the British Museum. I went on expeditions and collected wild plants for them with other British scientists. I was so lucky, and we had the whole world to explore, and students, if you had a student card, you could get into museums for free. I went to almost every museum in Europe. It was just free-falling through life, and that's when my real education began. And the earth sciences, the geology, a field is a field. It's a kind of science that has an incomplete record, and this would be in deep time. Astrophysics and geology are the only two sciences that have deep time, where they go back even billions of years, even to the beginning of the creation of the Earth and the universe. And the Earth is 4.5 billion years old. So geoscientists must take the fossil record or other types of data that give you a historic perspective, and it's incomplete. So they have to use other disciplines to fill in the gaps in where the data is missing. And so they kind of make a cartoon, in a way, of what has happened throughout Earth history, the history of the Earth. And I think it was because it's interdisciplinary, and I'm sort of a polymath. I'm interested in not just science, not just geology, but many, many things.
Yeah, me too.
And because we're polymaths, and because we have that inclusive perspective, a global perspective, a universal perspective, and because we're both indigenous, I think we both have very strong indigenous characteristics in our personalities and how we use information and how we think. I just had a very different approach to science than other scientists. And science in the 20th century has become very, very focused. And the scientists are over-specialized.
Exactly.
And they know everything about that little volcano that they sit on the rest of their lives and publish papers about that maybe 20 people read. But they're world experts on Popocatépetl or Colima or the volcano in Mexico or whatever. But they don't know anything outside of their little world.
I would like to put a little line there. They cannot know everything because they know only a little part of the very fraction of specialization. And if you just study the real part, the little part that is not connected to all the other parts of the whole, then you can't know even this little part, because you know don't know the connections to the whole world and how it all fits together and the whole magic of it.
But that's the disaster that happened to science in the 20th century. And so scientists like us who want to know more and to integrate what their specialty is into a bigger picture of understanding are not popular at all. they don't like us because we're not specialists. So also, your education is not in the classroom and it's not the professor. University is the library. And today in America, and through at least the last half of the 20th century, the universities actually were set up, even earlier in the 1800s, to train people for the workforce, to work for the graduates of the Ivy League colleges, who are the ruling elite. The oligarchs of America, they're the industrialists, and they're the bankers and the economists and the big movers and shakers. But that's very, very dangerous, and it's the result of capitalism. And it's capitalism, not overpopulation, that has caused global starvation. And we will talk about that as we go along today.
Yeah.
But I did a lot of times, I spent 10 years in Europe free-falling through life, and it was traveling with a purpose, with science as the purpose. And so that was sort of my framework and my roller skate to get around, was to be doing science. But I was really having a gigantic adventure in life.
Yeah.
And in how other people lived and thought. And that was my real education. It was meeting real people. It was going to museums. It was going on expeditions. And it was really a very unusual background and quite an adventure that most people don't get to have or even want to have. So I've been in 50 countries. And
wow.
I don't want to read what other people think about this and that. I want to go and I want to see it myself. I want to see the historic archaeological sites. I want to see where they fished and how they grew crops and how did they irrigate. And then I want to talk to the modern people to learn about their lives and what's important to them and how has their culture changed over thousands of years. So I really did have a wonderful time and people were wonderful and I learned a lot. But I can say my greatest learning experience was when I went to Hiroshima and Nagasaki and I saw the devastating effects of the atomic bombs that the United States government dropped on the two largest Christian populations in Japan.
Oh, God.
The hidden Christians. The government didn't even know there were that many Japanese Christians in Japan until those atomic bombs were dropped.
God, it's the first time I hear this aspect of it.
Yes. And so we'll talk about that also in today in our interview, but that was the beginning of weapons of mass destruction. And the weapons of mass destruction is how I started. I started in the year 2000 when I was invited for the first time to be an honored speaker at the plenary session of the Hiroshima and Nagasaki Memorial events, which last a whole month all over Japan.
Yeah.
People all over the world come every year to that memorial. And it was the most spiritual, it was the most disturbing, it was the most life-changing adventure, experience, whatever that I've ever had. And it completely changed my life. And I just like to say here that Gandhi had a saying that comes to me over and over again, and I'm sure you'll like it too. He said, "The miracle of the nuclear age is not how it changed the world, but how it changed you." And of course, I would never have been able to answer that question until I had visited Japan and seen the results of the first atomic bombings of human populations. And I...
But imagine how they dared to put Fukushima on them. I just can't believe it.
We'll get to that too. It's a whole shift in the strategy of war. And it's a very, very deep hidden secret because it takes you to the ancient Iranian bloodlines that have controlled the world for 5,000 years at least. And they poisons as a method of control.
I just have to interrupt you on this one, asking, this is a very exciting theory for me about Iranians, but it's the first time I really hear it from your mouth. And I am open to all sorts of theories about who are at the very top of these conspiracies, but I look at them all with open mind because I can't check any of them. They are just like sort of, as a scientist, I just have all threads open. This is sort of Rothschilds, Rockefellers, this is sort of aliens, this is, now it's a new one, there was reptiles too, David Icke, yeah. And then there is this new one with Iranians, there is Egyptian sort of theory.
It's based on DNA studies across the entire Eurasian continent. It's based on anthropology, physical characteristics. I based it on signs and symbols, not words and laws. And Confucius said, the world is run by signs and symbols, not words and laws. And when I finally realized that, because I also have a master's degree in Near Eastern Studies from UC Berkeley, the ancient history of Central Asia and the Middle East.
Yeah.
And so I recognized elements of that period that are everywhere, right in front of our eyes. They're in the halls of Congress.
They're on
the paintings of the American presidents. They're,
that's for sure. But I mean, those studies of DNA and all these studies, they are all word, the results of them. And we cannot check them because it's just lines of words again.
It's physical measurements. It's mathematically based. It is science. And it's irrefutable. There are too many components, the artistic symbols, the iconography, the languages, the physical characteristics of the anthropological studies, the genetic material passed on through generations, through thousands of years. All these things, when they all converge, and even the animal world is part of it too, and when it all converges, and the physical world of nature, and the anthropological information, and archaeological information of humans, when all of that fits together, it is irrefutable. And until I did that, I could not understand what the big picture was, how everything was put together, who was calling all the shots or controlling the world. And I also discovered that my bloodlines and my family were all part of that. And that unwritten corporate record that is passed down, even unspoken, is still who we are thousands of years later.
Okay, sorry for that interruption, but let's go on further with the Japan route.
Well, so the Japanese bombings started or introduced the nuclear age, and then we went on to a big development in nuclear weapons, and by many countries the bomb testing ended in 1963. President Kennedy was very, very concerned about American children dying from the fallout. So he worked with the Soviets, and the Soviets, Great Britain, and the United States signed the Partial Test Ban Treaty in 1963, ending atmospheric testing in order to save children's lives. But they were also saving the environment. And because that ended, the powers at the top came out with a new way to introduce radiation into the environment because they were actually using it for depopulation, for genocide, an invisible global genocide.
The new killer weapons, as they call it.
Yes. And then the Chernobyl disaster that was triggered, it was used to weaken Russia, weaken the Soviet Union, and end the Cold War, so they could move into the development of the HAARP system. And so it was sort of a frozen conflict, the Cold War was. But they needed it to create huge amounts of money for the U.S. to use secretly to develop the HAARP system. And it was covertly developed during the Cold War with the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union and the United States have always been good friends, and they always will be. They collaborate, they cooperate, they're pretend enemies in this Hegelian dialectic between these two superpowers, but their economies would collapse if they weren't enemies and in a perpetual state of war, whether it was a Cold War or an active war.
That's right.
And so I had so much to study. And so from that time...
This is the war economy they have built. This is the war economy. It's very important. It's not a peace and love economy system. This is a war economy. And then there was this report. Or what was the... Do you know that one?
Iron Mountain Report,
where they exactly said that if we stop this war economy, then we will lose the power over the planet.
The whole world economy would collapse.
But the economy would collapse, but then we would find another good system to run it.
Yes, but they're not going to let us do
no,
that.
No, exactly. They wouldn't like to.
No. They're firmly in control. And so... The HAARP system came out of that, which is weaponizing nature and natural processes. So first, there was peaceful trading on the Silk Road for 5,000 years. And then gunpowder was invented by the Chinese. But they just used it for fireworks, and maybe they'd make a little bomb, and one group of horsemen would throw that little bomb that would explode and make, you know, smoke and fire at another group of nomadic tribal people. But it wasn't really a big weapon because they didn't really have big wars then. They traded peacefully. And they had a very, very active spice trade in Southeast Asia where Middle Easterners came in ships to India, to Mohenjo-Daro, to get the beautiful cotton, just diaphanous cotton, so thin you can see through it. It's the cotton we love. It's wonderful because it has very long fibers. And then they would go and trade around Southeast Asia, the island arcs, Malaysia, Indonesia, all that region, Vietnam, and then they went and they had an active trade with China. And it was the kingdom of the Ryukyus later, after the Crusades, where China and other countries did their trading. And that is now the area called the Okinawa and the islands of Okinawa. But at one time, it was the kingdom of the Ryukyus. And I've actually stayed in the home of the king of the Ryukyus and his queen. They live in an apartment building near the palace. And so all of these adventures that I had, I met people, all kinds of people. And I said, my goodness, this is a really old region. And Europe and the United States are really very young compared to Asia and Southeast Asia. I was surprised. And then I started working with indigenous people, and they go back thousands and thousands, 40, 80,000, 100,000 years. So We're looking at a very long corporate memory that's 100,000 years old, at least. And what is 250 years or 275 years the age of the United States? They don't know anything.
Exactly.
They absolutely don't know anything.
That's a very fresh construction.
They gave up as immigrants. I'm not talking about the Native Americans, but the immigrants, European immigrants, who started coming in the 1400s and 1500s and 1600s, they came to America and gave up their cultures, their land, their religions. They gave up everything to come here.
That's right. And they lost their identities.
Completely. And your identity, if you're indigenous, is internal. Your validation is internal. The external material world isn't that important. But the immigrants who came to the United States had no internal validation or self-value. So they were victims of the people in control who created external validation, houses, cars, leather shoes with tassels on them, whatever you want to call something important or of value. It's not really that has value. The only real currency is labor. And it's because labor produces things that have value. This paper currency that was created is just a fraud. It's what the bankers trade for people's labor. They give them paper and they get real value back. And so the whole economic system has created a slave economy, because basically we're slaves, and that's
exactly
what the universities are for. It's to train these slaves to work for the rich people. And they think they're educated, but my daughter went to the University of California, Davis, as an entering freshman a few years ago, and she came back and she said, "Mom, they told us in orientation, you are not here to get an education. You're here to get trained for the workforce." Yeah. She said, "Mom, is that true?" And I said, "Don't worry. The professor in the classroom are not the university. You don't even need them. They need you."
And they don't even hide it anymore. They don't hide it anymore.
They don't hide it anymore. And I said, the library is the university.
But unfortunately, I have to say, Lorraine, library is not good enough at all. Because I started my sciences with gender economy. I developed feminism concept, because feminism is not enough, you need masculism. And one way to check library, go into library and write a keyword, masculism. There is no literature on it. You have only feminist, thousands of books, and there is no masculism at all. I just went into Alexandria, the burned down classical library place. And that's where, in Egypt, I also wrote in masculism, zero. Zero.
Yes.
Sorry for interruption. So it's not enough. It's not enough at all, this written literature. It's a fraud and it's a trap.
So let's go back to where this started and where and how it has arrived at the situation today. Because when you go back in deep time, and you look at, we'll start 5,000 years ago with the Silk Road, and that is going to explain everything that is so opaque today and people are unaware of. They're simply victims of it. And I spent from the year 2000 until maybe 2010 only studying science 18 hours a day on radiation. And finally, I was sitting there one day, and I'd been doing research on the terrible effects of radioactive fallout on the whole planet. at decline in mental ability, many new illnesses and diseases, heart disease and brain disease had the biggest increase. And finally, one day, I just sat there and I said, this can't be an accident. Chernobyl couldn't have been an accident. How could these disasters happen? There are all these 10 levels of safety measures that have to be dismantled in order for Chernobyl to happen. It couldn't have been.
Exactly, exactly.
Yeah. So, and a Navy admiral confirmed that. Admiral Vishnu Bhagwat, who was head of the Indian Navy, turned to me one day and he said, Chernobyl was planned and it was carried out to end the Cold War.
That's right.
And so it was.
And it did. It did destroy Soviet Union.
Yes, it did. And I did this Google search on University of California plus Skull and Bones. University of California has the sole management contract since World War II to manage the nuclear weapons labs in the United States. Now, why is the university managing, why are they making weapons of mass destruction? Well, they need all the students. And so the physics department pumps students into the nuclear weapons programs, and the university pumps administrators in, and chemists in, and biologists in, and microbiologists in, and planners, and all of this. It's a great academic machine to produce weapons of mass destruction.
Yeah, so, and they have this organization, Phi Beta Kappa, yeah?
Yeah.
That so, sort of has, it sort of has this network of this university
well,
grid.
Well, all this, the way they control
of the world.
The way they attract the students and they hold them in the system, so that they'll keep making weapons of mass destruction.
That's right. They don't even see that they're doing it.
No, they
because
don't.
Each one of them has some little department to run.
All of a sudden, they're getting all this attention as undergraduate or graduate students.
That's right. Career is the Satanist word.
They're nothing but slaves.
Exactly.
So the professors and the system make them feel special and reward them for producing these great ideas that are compartmentalized, but they're parts of horrific plans to destroy humanity.
That's right.
And so they get in that trap and they can't get out.
And how hard they work. I'm so astonished about these young, beautiful, fertile women and men sitting there sort of by the computers and books, like sort of contractually, frenetically working off their brains from morning to evening. Sort of they become psychiatrically not well, really.
They're automatons. They're obsessed with it. And
so much frenetic work is really insane.
Control.
Yeah.
They are under mind control. I went to UC Davis in the 60s, and out in an old peach orchard that the university owned, they had a monkey colony. And that monkey colony, the students who worked there would come back and say the monkeys had the top of their heads cut off and wires coming out of their brains. And I said, what for? And they said, well, they're doing mind control studies, animal studies. And then I discovered many, many years later that when I finally interviewed a man who'd been in the Vietnam War, but he was kidnapped as an 8-year-old and taken into that mind control program at Livermore in a country farmhouse that's still there today, and it's still being used for mind control experiments. And the animal studies at Davis were converted for human application at the Applied Science Facility at Davis, which was set up by Dr. Edward Teller. And Dr. Edward Teller became known as Dr. Strangelove globally for his mass megalomania and psychopathy, because people like that want to build bigger and bigger bombs to kill more and more people. And they're not any
different. These people are just not well. They are not. They are insane, really.
They're insane. And they want to, I mean, they start out as probably in gangs. Or gangs and gang leaders have the same mentality, the same mechanism, the same social structure as the psychopaths in the weapons of mass
or lonely destruction. Narcissists. That's another. Lonely narcissist is another sort of type.
So what I want to do is go back to the Silk Road 5,000 years ago.
Yeah.
And we know about Mesopotamia and Sumeria, the Hittites, the Egyptian Empire. And what people don't know is that the Silk Road was a Southeast Asian economy that went on for 5,000 years at least, with extensive trading all along the entire Eurasian continent, from the Pacific Ocean and China to the Atlantic Ocean, Portugal, and the Atlantic countries bordering the Atlantic Ocean. And all of the people, all Europeans, came from Central Asia. Everybody came from Central Asia. That's the origin of the Eurasian population. And the DNA studies prove that Europeans have more Mongolian blood than any of the tribes in Central Asia other than the Mongolians. And I've always had very white skin and very dark hair, but when I went out in the sun, I just turned the color of a nice pecan of the shell, nice and brown, a really even, pretty color. And I always wondered, how could I have such white skin and yet just turn so brown? And
so does my blonde daughter did that as well. She turned very brown in
because
Greece.
She has Mongolian blood, and she has a red tone to her skin. You have a red tone to your skin. I have a red tone to my skin, and it's the Mongolian blood. We don't even know that. You see, this is what I discovered. Not just about the world around me, but what I discovered about myself. And the Mongolians and the Asians, the Eurasians, had, the Europeans were in the Stone Age and the Bronze Age when they had great empires. And they traded all over the Eurasian continent. It's incredible what they did. And how did they do it? Well, the equestrian warriors of ancient times, the Scythians from Central Asia, for instance, the Mongolians, the Cossacks, many, many tribes, wandered back and forth across the entire Eurasian continent from the Atlantic to the Pacific, through the steppe, which is what we call the prairie. It's grasslands, and because of climate constraints and characteristics, there is a belt at the same latitude across the whole Eurasian continent, and that's where wild horses originated. Przewalski's wild horse is still in the wild in Mongolia. And those equestrian warriors brought the wild horse and these wagons that they called chariots, four-wheeled wagons that they dragged their yurts around on, these portable houses, round houses that we know in Siberia and Mongolia and Eastern China. they needed something to carry them on, so they invented these wagons. When they took them and introduced them, the Hittites, to the Middle East, they took two wheels off and turned them into chariots, war chariots. And so writing, science, astronomy, mathematics, seafaring, it all came from Central Asia and from the Indus Valley in India. And Mohenjo-Daro is one of the most famous archaeological sites, but the Indians also had big astronomical institutes set up where they observed the stars. And there, I've seen Native American paintings on walls of ancient houses of theirs in the Southwest, and they were recording supernovas exploding. And the same supernova, that same supernova explosion, was reported in documents that the Chinese and the Middle Easterners kept. So there's one supernova event that's documented all over the world globally by different cultures reporting on the same event. Isn't that incredible? Because they were very in tune with and very aware of natural events. And I can tell you, the Western scientists, the theoretical physicists, when they were first discovering the atom and how it was structured, they could not understand why it looked different from every direction that you mathematically looked at it from. And it was Niels Bohr from Copenhagen who went to Asia finally for 2 years to study ancient religions, and it was in Taoism that he got his answer. It was relativity. Relative to where your position was of observation of the atom, you would see one thing. And if you moved to another position and looked at the same thing, it looked different because it was relative.
Yeah, of course.
And so he went back to Copenhagen and he introduced the theory of relativity. And actually, European scientists could not really resolve what the atom, how it was really structured, until he came back with that theory.
But they have gone too far with that theory, haven't they?
And he was awarded a knighthood by the Danish king, and the Danish king said, you must select the symbols to put on your coat of arms. And what do you think is on his coat of arms?
Tell us.
The yin and the yang.
Of course.
The symbol, the black and white symbol. And that represents perpetual motion. It's the dance of the universe.
And duality.
And it's a continual a transition of waves, energy waves, into matter, and matter into energy waves. And that's the world we live in. So we have waves, light, and electricity, and sunlight, and artificial light, and all kinds of light, and waves, x-rays, seismic waves from earthquakes, radioactive materials emitting energy from the nucleus, ejecting it. That's a form of waves, the alpha particles, beta particles,
yeah,
the neutrons, and the gamma rays. That's all the waves that are converted to matter, and when it creates an unstable nucleus, the nucleus ejects the extra energy as waves. And those waves go out and they get turned into matter somewhere.
That's right.
And so that's what the universe is. It's a completely dynamic system that is constantly changing, and stars are being created and they're dying, and all of the elements, all of the matter that our world is made of, our infrastructure, is made, it was all made in star processes. And so uranium and plutonium are created under immense temperature and pressure regimes that are unknown on this Earth. And it's called a supernova.
Yeah.
So, so going back to the Silk Road, these people were very scientific. And in Asia, you cannot separate religion from science. So many of the monks are scientists. And I've never experienced anything like that in the Western world. So Asia was a very different experience for me. And I really matured. I gained more confidence, but also I finally committed in the Hiroshima and Nagasaki museums to spend the rest of my life warning humanity, educating humanity about the dangers of nuclear technologies. And guess who helped me? One of the last living Manhattan Project scientists. He was 83 when I met him. And he mentored me, he nurtured me, he was my father, my grandfather, my brother, my uncle, my friend, and he taught me social self-confidence, scientific self-confidence, and he was thrilled to
tell his name.
He was thrilled to be teaching someone. He couldn't believe he was teaching a woman. He really didn't expect that.
What was his name?
Oh, his name was Marion Folk. And Marion Folk was at the University of Chicago. He was from a German family. They still spoke German at home, and they lived on a farm. And he spent a lot of time in the barn milking cows.
Wow! Did he?
He went off to the University of Chicago, and it was World War II, and the nuclear weapons program broke out, the Manhattan Project, and Enrico Fermi was there. Edward Teller was a grad student there, and Marion Folk, as an undergraduate, was selected to go to Los Alamos Nuclear Weapons Lab and work on the Manhattan Project. And he lived to be 95 years old, and he was always very careful about radiation exposure, and he told me to never go to a contaminated area or place because I would become exposed. And so I'm so glad he told me that because it's a rule that I will not break. And he went as an undergrad to Los Alamos and he was studying biological effects of radiation there. And when he got out, he went to the Ball Corporation. They make canning jars for food. And what most of these corporations, big corporations in America have is a weapons development program. And he was in the space program and he designed the first solar powered satellite. And it was only supposed to work for a year, but I don't know, 40 years later, it was still working. And it was used by General Schwarzkopf and those guys in the first Gulf War.
They knew how to build things then.
And he even had to develop a lubricant that could tolerate extreme temperatures, very hot and very cold temperatures. And he had the patent on it, but the government gets that, or the corporation does.
Of course, yeah.
And he's the one who made the hydrogen bomb work.
Gosh.
For the United States government. Teller did not invent the hydrogen bomb. He did not make the hydrogen bomb work. And he said very carefully, other people refer to me as the father of the hydrogen bomb. But every time his name came up, Marion Folk would start laughing and giggling, and he said, and he never told me for 8 years that he had made the hydrogen bomb work. My family are Huguenots. They're Quakers. They're pacifists. They're anti-war. And said, and he knew that I hated bombs and war. So, and I'm from five generations of military families too. So he was always really reticent to tell me that. And one day, I guess he trusted me enough of after 8 years, he turned to me and he said, oh, I know you're not going to like this, but I made the hydrogen bomb work. And do you still like me?
That's a good one.
And I said, of course I do. I love you. And I know that you did out of patriotism and thinking that you were saving your country. I know that. All the scientists were told that. And so don't feel bad at all about that. So we got over that. But going back to the Silk Road, in this period of bringing horses and chariots into the Mediterranean region, well, who were those people? They were, a lot of them were the Tajiks and the Uzbek tribes, the Iranian tribes, the Indo-European or Aryans, and most Europeans have evolved from those people. They were also the best makers of silk. They made exquisite silk, beautiful dyeing, beautiful weaving, and they made damasks and every kind of just gorgeous silk that you can imagine. And they traded for thousands of years all along the Silk Road, and they became very, very, very rich. Very rich, richer than anyone. And so they went into the Mediterranean region, and the Farnese family, which we know today, is an ancient Iranian bloodline, and these bloodlines go through the females, not the males. And it's because the most important things are inherited from the mother, the female, and that is the mitochondria that provide all of the energy for the body. And that's why indigenous people know that the female, when you're breeding animals, is the most important part of the breeding pair. Because if the female doesn't have good mitochondria, you're not going to get a fast horse. You're not going to get a really healthy or full of stamina or a strong, hardworking oxen or goats or whatever.
And so, not to forget in the sperm wars, that's the only reliable, trustworthy information of who is the mother, you always know, but who is the father is always under question.
Well, the father
socially.
Father isn't so important. It's the female and the mitochondria from the female that are important.
And it is less likely to know the exact father, too.
And what we do know from the RNA and the DNA and the mitochondria is that the Americas were settled. All of the Indians in the Americas came from Central Asia, Mongolians primarily. But in recent studies, just in the last year or two, they have found, for instance, an arm bone of a teenage boy from thousands of years ago. And he had very complex DNA indicating that his blood had come from a consortium of different cultures and people. And that would indicate the Silk Road environment, and so these Sogdians were another tribe besides the Tajiks and the Uzbeks, and slowly over time the Uzbeks they were Zoroastrian Mithra worshippers, and they had certain physical characteristics and features, And they're very beautiful people, very white skin and very black hair. But they're also redheads with blue eyes that appeared in this population even 40,000 years ago from a mutation. And they are a form of extreme albinism in those tribes. And less severe albinism, where this gene is modified, this mutation, is those are the blondes and green eyes and hazel eyes. But all the blondes and redheads and blue eyes and green eyes and hazel eyes and even gray eyes came from those Iranian tribes.
Very interesting theory. Very interesting.
And the and they went, they moved through Russia, they went up into Scandinavia, they explored all over Europe, and they mixed with the Neanderthals or whoever was there. And so then Europe began to grow and to develop. But it's these Iranian tribes that also spilled over the Himalayas. What happens is it was in the Fergana Valley primarily. And the population would build up, and the population would, part of it would leave to find new opportunities. In other words, a new valley to live in with their horses and raise their sheep and goats and everything, camels. And so they spilled over into the Himalayas, into northern India.
Sorry, Lorraine. Can we take in Henning? He's coming to us. He's so brilliant. Let's have him. He's calling. Henning?
Yeah, hey.
Ah.
Hallo.
Hey, Henning. Can we talk English? I'm in the middle of the second conference of criminalized nuclear war systems.
Okay, yes.
And I was calling you just when I started the interview with Lorraine Moray.
Okay, yeah.
And now I interrupted the interview with her.
We can talk later.
No. I'm taking her on now. We will talk, we will have a triangle.
Okay.
So, just so you do know the conference, you have been on it.
Yes.
So, I'm just taking her in now. So, where do I add her on? The communication is not easy. Do you have 5 minutes to be with us, Henning?
Yes, yes.
Great. Lorraine is not with us. So, how do we add her?
Well, there are a plus.
Ah, there it is.
A white sign with a plus sign.
Okay, where is she? Let's try again. I can't find her. Lorraine. Lorraine Murray. Hello, Lorraine. I couldn't get you on back, but Henning is with us. I'll try to get him in now. Technical. So, white TV, you know, remember, yeah?
Uh-huh.
So, Henning Witte, getting him in. Sorry for this interruption, but we are sort of divine interruptions, you know. Oh, there it is. Henning, are you with us now?
Yes, Henning is here.
And Lorraine is coming in too, I think. Yeah, are you with us, Lorraine?
Hi, I'm on screen.
Great, great. Okay, I would like to introduce you two guys. Lorraine, this is Henning Witte from Sweden, from Stockholm, a German lawyer, a very famous researcher of major conspiracies such as Estonia sink, where 800 yep. people died. This is the man, this is the master, Henning Witte, and he has also been absolutely stunningly brilliant in the after he did research how to reform banking system.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, he is really a genius. And Henning, this is Lorraine Murray. She's...
Oh, I know who she is. I read her books and saw the interviews with Alfred Lambert.